We have a show and tell in honor of the Indianapolis 500 that was last week. That's not what it's in honor of, but it's timely anyway with that. And the show and tell is not that car in the middle. It is the people all working around it. And as you probably know, that's called a pit crew, right? And their job is to change all the tires on that car and add fuel to it in about 10 seconds, six times during a race. And every person on that crew has their own specific, unique job to do, right? There's no one person on that crew who could do all that work, even in six times as long. I mean, they could do it eventually, right? But it would take them a while. And so every person on that team gets to celebrate the unique skills and work and effort that everybody else on that team is putting in all at the same time. They all count on each other to do the work that only they should do. And when we see people doing different jobs, especially jobs that, like, we just don't connect with, right? Jobs that I just really shouldn't be doing because I'm no good at it, or jobs that really don't actually connect me directly with who God is, we can still celebrate that those different jobs and different roles and different gifts are all ways of serving God. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from early in the life of the church, and it's a moment when we notice that the life of the church depends on all of our different gifts, all of our experiences, all of our identities. And so we celebrate that today. Will you join me in a prayer for illumination? Spirit of God, descend upon our hearts. Be poured out on us all and fill us with prophecies, visions, and dreams of the world made new. Teach us to love you and love our neighbors as we ought to love. Amen. The scripture reading this morning comes from Acts chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. Now, during those days, when the disciples were increasing in number, the Hellenists, the Greek speakers, complained against the Hebrews, those who spoke Aramaic, because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution of food. And the 12 called together the whole community of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should neglect the word of God in order to wait on tables. Therefore, friends, select from among yourselves 7 men of good standing, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we may appoint to this task, while we, for our part, will devote ourselves to prayer and to serving the word." What they said pleased the whole community, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, together with Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. They had these men stand before the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. The word of God continued to spread, the number of the disciples increased greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests became obedient to the faith. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. William played "Let Us Break Bread Together." That's what I'm really looking forward to this morning. I've also been looking forward to singing together, and that felt good. That felt good this morning. And I understand those for whom it's not safe enough yet. We understand that as well. And I get it particularly around singing, as that is a particularly risky activity for those who are not yet vaccinated or who have other health concerns. We have been singing and breaking bread individually for 15 months now. And coming back together in this room to do that is new and strange, even as it is joyful and a relief. And what I'm most looking forward to is the sacrament, sharing food and drink together in Jesus' name. Because, you know, sermons are nice, but we also know that worship is a whole lot more than just being talked to, even by someone as wonderful as yours truly. But the sacrament is this deeply embodied moment of sharing, when we actually take Christ's presence into our bodies together. And that's more than just when we interact with God through our brains, whether that's with logic and all these words or emotions and the beautiful gift of music. But Christ is present in sharing together, and especially in that sharing together in our bodies. And that's why that your bread at home also embodies Christ's presence with us, and we thank God for that as well. So there are lots of reasons that a lot of us prefer being together in person, even those of us who are not ready to be together in person yet. We are longing for this because our bodies matter. Our bodies matter as we come together. The scripture reading comes to us from a time in the early church when the early church was living out this new community, yes, in their bodies, not only in words. We are learning the stories of women in the early church. The early church, that time when Christianity was still that weird apocalyptic hippie commune that the book of Acts describes to us. And it was growing and blossoming in these amazing ways. And the women, you could be forgiven for missing the women in our story today, but it's all about them. This particular set of women prompts a growing pain in that growing early church. These were Greek-speaking widows. Widows were not just women whose husbands had died, but also who had no surviving sons. And so they had no means of economic support in the world. And so the early church, you can imagine, was popular with widows. Because the early church was this family that took its household responsibilities seriously and took responsibility even for people who were not, according to the society around them, part of their household. And so today, we run into these questions about what we mean when we say that the church is a family. The early church is protecting widows like their own mothers and orphans like their own children, but what about widows on the other side of that ethnic boundary? These Greek-speaking women in this majority Aramaic-speaking region, what does that mean? Now, never fear, in the next several weeks, those boundaries will expand even farther to include women not only with speaking parts in the story, but with their own households and leadership roles in the church. The family of faith will keep growing and growing eventually to include Covenant Presbyterian Church, among others. And every time the family of faith grows, we have to renegotiate how to be family together. And so that's where we are in today's scripture reading. The apostles hear this issue between the widows who speak different first languages, and it's an equity question. And so the apostles hear this question of, is everyone getting what they need in the daily food service? And the apostles recognize that they are not the right people to solve that problem. To their credit, they recognize that they're not the right people to solve the problem, and they recognize that the problem is real. They don't decide, oh, well, this problem can't exist because it doesn't apply to us. They take this seriously, and they begin the solution with those women who said, hey, we're not getting what we need. The ones who are directly affected, who know what the problem is and understand better than anyone else what needs to be done. And then the apostles did something kind of cool. They empowered non-Judeans for the first time in the life of the church. Now, the people they empowered were men because patriarchy was not completely dead yet. But they empowered men with Greek names, men who could identify with the need that these widows were experiencing. I keep saying the apostles empowered them. The apostles did almost nothing here. The Holy Spirit empowered these who we would come to call deacons. The Holy Spirit was already at work filling those seven with the gifts that they would need for that ministry. The biggest lesson from the book of Acts is that the Holy Spirit is always at least a mile ahead of us, wherever it is we think we are leading. And if you read this story properly, what you see is the apostles, the early church, celebrating these different gifts that are poured out on one community for the sake of one gospel to be lived out in all these different ways. And I point that out one more time to make sure we hear it, in contrast to the church's kind of history of lifting up this job right here, the ministry of the word, as if it's the only thing that ultimately matters, which, you know, we did because it conveniently helped to keep men in charge for like centuries and centuries longer than we should have been. Now, I love my calling to teach the word. I love what I get to do right now, and I am especially glad that we tie this talking part with thoughts and feelings to this part, this sacrament part that happens at the table when we eat and we drink together, we wash together. I love that those are connected because preaching is not the only thing the church is here to do. Preaching is not the only way we proclaim who Jesus is in the world. And so when the apostles affirm not just words and sacraments, but physical ministry to people's direct physical needs, that's when the church grows again. That's what Acts tells us. Grows in numbers and in faithfulness. Today in our moment for mission, which happens there at the time that we celebrate the offering, we are going to celebrate our teachers who have served our kids and youth this year. Those who have served at Word and tables, who have served souls and bodies as we have gathered, whether virtually or in person. You're going to see pictures of lessons that feed that left brain. You're going to see crafts and music that feed that right brain. You're going to see games that feed and involve that whole body. You'll see hands-on service that ties our bodies and our souls together for the sake of our neighbors. And you will see that connection, that physical embodied connection between leaders and kids, online when we needed to be, in our bodies together when we could. The kingdom of God is here in these bodies, in person or online. And I praise God for every way that we share God's love with each other. Amen. I invite you to gratitude and faithfulness. Today we celebrate the volunteers who have supported our kids and youth programming this year. This year we give a special thank you to those Wednesday night volunteers who have done whatever is needed during the pandemic. We bounced back and forth more than once between virtual teaching and in-person activities, sometimes at only a day or two's notice. In normal years, we call those volunteers forward so that we can celebrate them. Today, we will show a video tribute so that both you here in the sanctuary and you watching at home can celebrate those volunteers. As Covenant's family, we are so grateful for the time all of our volunteers give. Thank you so much.